We have our responsive reading this morning. If you would, stand with me. I will begin, then you follow after me. I will pray the Father, and He will give you another Helper, that He may abide with you forever. I will not leave you orphans. I will come to you.
And now I go away to Him who sent me, and none of you ask me, where are you going?
But because I have said these things to you, sorrow has filled your heart.
Nevertheless, I tell you the truth, it is to your advantage that I go away. For if I do not go away, the Helper will not come to you.
And when He has come, He will convict the world of sin and of righteousness and of judgment.
And of sin, because they do not believe in me.
Of righteousness, because I go to my Father and you see me no more.
Of judgment, because the ruler of this world is judged.
I still have many things to say to you, but you cannot bear them now. He will glorify me, for He will take of what is mine and declare it to you. All things that the Father has are mine. Therefore I say that He will take of mine and declare it to you. Let's remain standing. Let's sing together. Holy Spirit, Thou art welcome in this place. Let's sing together.
Welcome in this place, Holy Spirit, Thou art welcome in this place. Omnipotent Father of mercy and grace, Thou art welcome in this place. Lord, in Thy presence there's healing divine. No other power can save, Lord, but Thine. Holy Spirit, Thou art welcome in this place. Thou art welcome in this place. Fill all the hungry and empty within. Restore us, O Father, revive us again. Holy Spirit, Thou art welcome in this place. Thou art welcome in this place.
And our prayer this morning, Holy Spirit, rain down upon us today and let your glory be shown. Let's sing together. Holy Spirit, rain down.
Holy Spirit, rain down, rain down. Oh, Comforter and Friend, how we need your touch again. Holy Spirit, rain down, Let your power fall, let your voice be heard. Come and change our hearts as we stand on your word. Holy Spirit, rain down. No eye have seen, no ear has heard, no mind can know what God has in store. So open up heaven, open it wide, over your church and over our lives. Holy Spirit, rain down, rain down. Oh, Comforter and Friend, now we need your touch again. Holy Spirit, your voice be heard. Come and change our heart as we stand on your word. Holy Spirit, rain down.
Amen. This time I'd like to invite you to join me here at the altar as we pray together, as asking what we've just sung. So if you'll please join me here as we bow together and pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for the opportunity we have to, with our voices, express the desires of our hearts. And Lord, truly, I know that as we have voiced together, we desire that your Holy Spirit would rain down in this place. I pray that we would hear your voice, we would hear your word, we would hear your instructions. And Father, as a result of our hearing, that it would bring us to obedience. And Lord, as we obey, we know that you will bless, and we know that you will use us in the kingdom that is coming. Lord, we pray that you would bless us with just an outpouring of your presence. We pray, Lord, that we would be changed from the inside out. We pray, Father, that you would have your way in this place. We pray that you would rule and that you would reign. And Father, we ask these things now in Jesus' name. Amen. At this time, I'd like to welcome those who are our guests here today. We're honored that you're here. And right in front of you in the pew, there should be some guest cards. If you would just take one of those out and fill it out and put in the offering plate when it comes by. Just having a record of you being here, we're glad that you've chosen. But just so glad that we get to worship today a risen King. Amen? Our King is not dead. Our King is risen. Amen.
If you would just remain seated and let's sing this song together. How deep the Father's love for us. Let's sing together.
How deep the Father's love for us. How vast beyond all measure that he should give his only Son to make a wretch his treasure. How great the pain of searing loss. The Father turned his face away as wounds which mark the chosen one brings many sons to glory.
hand that held him there until it was accomplished. His dying breath had brought me life. I know that it is finished. I will not boast in anything. No gifts, no power, no wisdom. But I will boast in Jesus Christ, His death and resurrection. Why should I gain from His reward? I cannot give an answer. But this one with all my heart, His wounds have paid my ransom.
And we all say, amen. If you would, let's stand as we repeat our memory verse for this week. Your word is a lamp unto my feet and a light for my path. Psalm 119, 105. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for this time that we can just remember what you've done for us upon the cross of Calvary over 2,000 years ago. And Lord, we thank you for the sacrifice that was made on our behalf. We thank you for the amazing grace that you have shown so freely to us as a people. And we thank you for a time we could be here just to worship you in the freedom that we have. We thank you for worship as we just worship you this time. As we return to you your tithes and our offerings. We ask you to bless this time of worship. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Your Bibles, I want to ask you to turn with me to the Old Testament, to the book of Psalms, chapter 95, is where I'll be reading from in a few moments. Let me ask you a question or so before we read the passage. If we were to ask, let's just say 100 students, what they considered the most or the greatest or the most important thing in their life for right now and also the future, I wonder what their response would be. Their response may be something like this. As a young person, know how I used to think. I would say, well, the most important thing for me right now is a new car. Right? You know, that's kind of where I was at one time. And then others may say, well, I would like to have a full ride scholarship to go to college. That's not a bad thing, right? That's a good thing. Others say, well, you know, I look forward to one day getting a good job. Others would say, well, yeah, I want a good job, but I'd like to have a good-sized house, a beautiful or a good spouse. Some would say a healthy family. And as you, as we mature in age, our things change. And we might say now that some may say, well, I want a comfortable retirement. Somewhere along the line, we've all said things along that. And nothing wrong with having those desires. But I want to submit to you a statement. And my statement is this: if you live 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, or 80 years and you don't know God, you've missed it all. Doesn't matter what you may accomplish or what you may have. If you miss knowing God, you've missed the meaning of life altogether. I would say, based on Scripture, that you've missed your reason for existence. And with that being said, I'm going to ask you to stand with me. I'm going to read to you Psalms 96, starting in verse 1. But I want you to just listen to what God says in His Word to us. And we know that we stand in honor of its authority. And I know the authority of God's Word has changed my life. It says this in verse 1. It gives us a declaration. Something that we are to do. It says, sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord all the earth. Sing to the Lord, praise His name. Proclaim His salvation day after day. Declare His glory among the nations. In other words, tell who He is. Declare His glory among the nations, His marvelous deeds among the people. In other words, what has He done? How has He revealed Himself to us? Declare His glory. Declare His deeds unto us. It goes on to say, verse 4, for great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. He is to be feared above all gods. For all the gods of the nations are idols, but the Lord made the heavens. Let's pray. Lord, we thank You so much for the authority of Your Word. We thank You for Your truth. And Lord, as we walk through this text and as we walk through the principles found throughout Your Word, Father, I pray that You would change us. May there be a holy discontent from within. May the things that hurt Your heart begin to hurt ours. And the things that bring joy to You, may that be our focus, our goal, and our desires. Lord, I do pray for myself that You would forgive me of my sins. That this morning as I stand before this, Your people, that I would stand as Your spokesman. I do pray that You would protect each one in this room from my words. But God, I pray Your word would cut our hearts. Lord, we love You. We adore You. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. You know, in verses 3 and following in Psalms, we're told to tell people about our God. We're to explain to the people of the world what God has done to reveal Himself to us. But notice what it says in verse number 5, the very last part. But the Lord made the heavens. And that's really where I want us to begin this morning. And I want you to flip back in your Bibles to the very first verse of Scripture in Genesis chapter 1, verse number 1. And we're going to talk about this morning where the gospel really began. We've been talking about the gospel for the last few weeks, and let's think about where the gospel really began. In Genesis 1, verse 1, this is what God's Word records. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Now, what that speaks to us about is, the Bible simply declares that God is behind everything. Now, let me take that a step further. Something did not come out of nothing. In the beginning, God created. That's where we want to begin as you think about the gospel. That's where it all began, with God. There is a creator. He did create the universe. And the creator who created the universe gave the universe purpose and meaning. Now, notice that the Bible does not begin with a debate. The Bible begins with a declaration. In the beginning, God. Now, either you believe this or you do not. And if you understand Genesis 1:1, if you believe it, you can believe everything else in the Bible. But if you doubt Genesis 1:1, if you stumble there, you will stumble at the rest of the message of the Bible. So Genesis 1:1 is very crucial. If you believe it, then the miracles are really no trouble whatsoever. But if you doubt Genesis 1:1, you will doubt everything else as well. Now the Bible says, in the beginning, God created. Now, those who doubt that, let me explain something about those who doubt that statement there. They will try to rationalize and explain away the stories and the characters of the Bible. For example, I have heard those as I went to EKU for 2 semesters. I heard one professor say that he doubted the miracle of the parting of the Red Sea. Had all kinds of evidence, he thought, about this, that, and the other thing, but he doubted the parting of the Red Sea. Also doubted the way the walls of Jericho fell in. No doubt, as the semester prolonged there, he doubted lots of other things as well. He doubted the virgin birth. He also doubted the walking on the water, said that there were stones under the water that only Christ knew about. You know, when you doubt Genesis 1:1, you will doubt everything else. The individual doubted the healing of the blind, and as I heard in this class, all these different things, I thought to myself, well, how do you know it's true? Then when we got back in our class, come to find out, he doubted the Genesis 1:1. In the beginning, God created. That's really where the gospel begins. It begins with God. Now, Genesis 1:1 is vital. It tells us when, in the beginning. It tells us who, God. And it tells us what, He created the heavens and the earth. Now, Genesis 1:1 is so dramatic. It's really a warning to man, since there is a beginning that God created, there also is an ending. Therefore, we must prepare to face the one who created it all. That's why, as we know what Scripture says, Romans 3:23, for all have sinned. We understand that. We know we're all in the same boat. We're all sinners. We also know that the Bible says that because of our sin, the wages of sin, it is death. We will die in our sin if we don't know Christ as our Savior. We will die separated from God and be there for all eternity. But we know the gospel. In the beginning, God created, and God sent a rescuer that for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son. Now what that gift did on our stead was that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. And my friends, those who call upon the name of the Lord, the Scripture says, will be saved. But it all begins in Genesis 1:1. Now that's why next Sunday on the 29th, we're going to start a journey together. We know the gospel. We know the story. We know how God came to us. He revealed Himself to us. And because of those truths, we're going to start a study on becoming a contagious Christian. And I was thinking about that statement. That's exactly what our world needs. Our world needs Christians who follow Jesus who are contagious. That's what they need to see. They need to hear. They need Christians who are magnetic in their faith and that will draw, will lift up Jesus with our lives. And as a result of that lifting up, God through our lives will draw men, women, boys, and girls to themselves. Now, next Sunday, as we start this process on Sunday morning, I'll be preaching and teaching along with what we'll be doing on Sunday night. So please, please sign up in the back so we can get you a book. Now you say, well, I don't know. Do you not want to be contagious in your faith? Why would you not want to be contagious in your faith? That does not compute in my mind. Why would I not want to be the most effective Christian in the world for God's kingdom and my Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ? So please sign up back there and we'll make more room. The list, there's about 40 on there. But we'll make room for more. Because I know I want to be contagious. Amen? That's what I want to be as a follower of Christ. Now, the Bible teaches us that God created. The Bible teaches us that man is separated from God because of our sin. The Bible teaches us there's only one way to be forgiven. And I said a few weeks ago, I'm not going to be mainstream. I'm not going to be politically correct. There's only one way to God, and that is the Lord Jesus Christ. Any other way will send you straight to hell. Fact. That's what Jesus said. And I trust what Jesus said in His Word. He is the only one who has conquered death, hell, and the grave. The one who rules and reigns today. I trust Him and His Word. And also we know that as a follower of Christ, I know that He has placed in my life the responsibility to share the good news. And I want to be the most effective Christian that I could ever be. Now, being contagious, that's what I desire. Infectious maybe is a good word. Our great God created us. He loved us. He has provided for us. He will forgive us. He is returning. And He is the one to whom we must all give an account. Now, what we share with others has to begin with God. That's what I want to share with you this morning, that history really is His story. That's what history is. Now notice with me, if you will, that first, our need is to know the God who made us. That is the need of every individual. Now, we are made to know God, and we have a need to know God. In fact, in Ecclesiastes chapter 3, it tells us that God has put eternity in our hearts, in the hearts of men. That means there is a God-shaped vacuum inside of us, in each person, that only God Himself can fill. And we will not be happy in this life until we allow God to fill that void. There's no way. Augustine prayed this prayer, "You have made us for Yourself, and our hearts are restless until they find their rest in You." So we restlessly search for God, and we always don't know what we're doing, but I can recall back before I met the Lord Jesus Christ, I was searching everywhere for happiness and for joy and for all those things that I thought would make me feel good about this life itself. And I was searching and going from one thing to the other, and I never found anything that satisfied. until I found Jesus. Nothing. You know, I'd been talking to someone last summer, and about the good news, wanting this person to give me the opportunity to share the gospel with them. And I'd been trying to work on that relationship to where they would trust me enough to say, hey, why don't you tell me about your life story? And I remember this day, I was out in the garden out here, and it was hot, it was dusty, and I'd been there for about an hour, and you know exactly what I looked like. Nasty. And I was sweating so much, and it was so dusty, I had mud kind of on my legs from all the dust that was blowing up with the wind and how dry it was and how wet I was. And as I was working through the garden, up pulls this person in their vehicle. They get out of their air-conditioned vehicle. What did they look like? They were calm. They were cool. They were clean. And here I was, a nasty mess. And I turned the tiller off, and I walked over, and I started talking to this person, and the whole time I was talking, I was doing this, and I was kind of wiping my hands off. You know, that's what you're doing, right? Now, why did I do that? Because this person was clean. What was I? Dirty, filthy, nasty is a good word. That's what I was. And I was trying to have a conversation, but I was so self-conscious about myself. I'm just dirty. I'm nasty. I look awful. Now take that thought that I had, multiply it times an infinity, and that's our problem with God. We're just nasty. We're just dirty. He is perfect. He has done nothing ever wrong. He is clean. He is pure. And we are everything but that. And we know that God is perfect. So what do we do? What do we do? Well, we do one of two things about the fact that God's perfect. Now, number one, what we may do is this. We make up our minds. Now, this is what our world does. We make up our minds that God should lower His standards. That's what what people do. They say, well, I don't like the fact that God's perfect, and I know that I'm not. And what God must do, He must lower His standards. We hope that He will stop demanding perfection, or maybe this thought. Maybe God will grade me on the curve. Maybe that'll be all right. Maybe I'll be just fine. My friends, hear me. If God lowered His standards, He would not be God. So we do, we say, all right, we make up our minds, we want God to lower His standards, or we begin to compare ourselves to others, and that's what we do oftentimes. We don't feel so bad as we look at someone else. We see their indiscretions, we see where they are wrong, and we say, well, compared to them over there, I fare pretty well. Or compare this one over here, I see what they do on Saturday, and I don't do that on Saturday, so I feel pretty good about myself. But my friends, comparing yourself to the person next door will never bring you closer to God. Never. So we make up our minds that God should lower His standards. Or we say, all right, we want to compare ourselves to other people. But notice with me, not only our need, but secondly, God has a desire that we should know Him. The whole Bible that we have in our hands, it tells us that God wants us to know Him. In a sense, that is really the theme of God's Word. How God created us, how we rebelled against God, how God sent His rescuer, His Son, to rescue those who He had created, who had turned against Him. See, God sent messengers. He sent to the human race. He didn't want us to go without Him. But what did we do? We ignored His message and sometimes killed His messengers. And then He sent His Son. And that ultimate expression of love, His Son, we killed Him too. But in His death, God made a way for anyone and everyone to be forgiven. Amen? What God has done. Now let's go back to the very beginning of our story for a moment. When God first created the world, He created Adam and Eve. He made them in His image, And also it says, after his likeness. Now that means that when you and I were made or created by God, we have the ability to know God personally. In fact, I would say that we have an unquenchable hunger that can never be satisfied in and of ourselves. We want to know God, but we can't do that on our own. You see, we have a problem. God created Adam and Eve. Yes, he did. They sinned in the Garden of Eden, and the image of God was in each one of us has been marred by sin ever since. See, we were made to know God, and we want to know him, but sin has created a gap and left us in a deep hunger that we cannot satisfy ourselves. But also, thirdly, notice with me that there is our search. We look in all the wrong places. So we have a need. We're made to know God. And we have God has a desire that we should know him, but we're on this search and we look in all the wrong places. You've heard that song, right? Looking for love in all the wrong, no, I'm not talking about. There's an old way to share the gospel using just a pen and a napkin at a restaurant. Hit the next slide, I believe. One more slide. There you go. You may have seen this. You can take a napkin. What you do on one side of the napkin, you draw a cliff and put us. On the other side of the napkin, you draw another cliff and put God. And us on this side, there's a great chasm between, and we can't get to the other side. And there's a hunger that's within us, and we want to get to the other side. And what do? We try everything under the sun. Well, if I get more money, or I get an education, if I get more power, or maybe science, or success, or approval, or relationships, or religion, and all of those things we try to get across to God are unsuccessful. See, we never can find God starting out from where we are. We can't get there. But here is the gospel. He came to us. Try as we might, we say, well, I'm here, and there's a great gulf between God and I, but I want to get where he's at, but everything I try, I just end up right in the middle in that great abyss, and I'm separated from him, and I can't get there. But the marvelous story, hit the next slide. See what Jesus did? He became that bridge. God came to us that we may be with him. So that's the gospel. We can't get there on our own, but God came to us. That is the mercy and the grace of God. And we search in all the wrong places, but nothing in this world can satisfy our longing, because nothing in this world can lead us back to God. God came to us. See, the answer that we need is outside of ourselves. It's God coming to us. Now, here's our problem. We are made to know God. There's a God-shaped vacuum inside of us that each one of us, and since we can't find God on our own, we search in all the wrong places, and there's still that eternal longing that is not fulfilled, and we try on our very own. But notice also with me God's solution. He has made himself known. Now, talk about a great truth. We can never know God unless he reveals himself to us. See, God's revealed himself in several ways. In creation. Everybody sees that. He reveals himself in creation. But also he reveals himself in the human conscience. And everybody knows, has this. He also reveals himself to us in his written word. Not everybody knows that. And in his written word, really and truly, he ultimately revealed himself in the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, who was Jesus? God incarnate. God clothed in human flesh. When Jesus walked on the earth, it was the God-man, fully God and fully man at the same time. Jesus Christ is the supreme revelation of Almighty God. And you know, you think about this, the Bible says a great deal about who God is and how He's revealed Himself, but there's some facts that I want to share with you and kind of bring us to a point this morning as we think about the gospel. Here's a fact about God. He is the sovereign Lord. That's who He is. He is a personal God. He is infinite. He is not subject to loss or corruption or decay. He is eternal. He always has been and always will be. He is the source of all that there is. His character is unchanging. He is entirely dependable, and what He says He will do. He is sovereign. He is holy. That means He is utterly pure. He is free from all evil. He is totally without blame or error. He never lowers His standards, never compromises, never makes a special deal. He makes no rules that people can object to. He Himself is the final judge of right and wrong. Doesn't matter what the masses may say, God is the ultimate judge of all. Therefore, everything He says about you and I is true. So we know that God is sovereign. Number two, He created all things. God designed us, everything about us. He initiated creation. He personally brought it into being. The universe did not happen by chance, nor by accident, or by random collision of cells. It is not the product of evolution. God spoke, and the universe came into being. All things were made by Him, and all things exist through Him. His powerful word. This means that God created us. He put us on the earth for a reason, and the highest purpose of our lives is to get to know the God who made us. Now, the truth is that God made us in His image. We were made to know God. Something in our heart just yearns to know God, and that yearning might be hidden for years, but deep within, or maybe you can even feel it this very morning, perhaps you've tried to cover it up or sweep it under the rug. It just won't work. Now, the truth is that He knows all about us. That's a scary thought, is it not? He knows everything about us. Past, present, and future. He is never caught by surprise. Never. Nothing is hidden from God about us. He knows our secret thoughts. He knows our dreams, our unfulfilled desires. He knows the words before you speak them and the thoughts that just entered your mind. He knows it all. He knows exactly where you were last night and who you were with. He knows the whole story of your life. He knows the good, the not so good, and the ugly. He knows everything. But also He cares about you. The Bible tells us that God is love. We know that He is perfect. His love is perfect. It is infinite. His love is not deserved. We should never get to the point and think, well, I deserve God's love. No, we don't. We don't deserve God's love. There's nothing in us that deserves His love apart from the marvelous grace He has. And that's the miracle. God loves the unlovely. He proved it when He sent His Son to the earth, that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. You know, if you live to be 30, 40, 50, 60, 70, or 80 years, and you amass a great amount of success and wealth and power, you're happy with life, and your family's healthy, your marriage is blessed, and it's all for nothing if you don't know God. You know, that'd be like going to visit Niagara Falls and never seeing the falls. That would be like traveling to Yellowstone and never seeing Old Faithful. That would be like going to Paris and not ever seeing the Eiffel Tower. Knowing God who made us is the most important thing in life. Now, it gives you meaning, knowing God does. It gives us purpose. And if we don't know God, you'll spend all of your days in the pursuit of things that will never satisfy. And then what do you do when you die? If you spend all of your time pursuing things that don't satisfy, what happens when you die? Because sooner or later, we're all going to expire. What do we do then? That question became very, very personal to a youth group at Wedgwood Baptist Church in Fort Worth, Texas on a Wednesday night 17 years ago. It was shortly after 7 p.m. 300 students had gathered in the sanctuary for a youth rally. They were celebrating what had happened that day. See you at the poll. We know what that is, right? Well, the students gathered together, flagpole across the street and across our country at schools. They were having a rally, a post-rally. While the students and the leaders were all fixed in singing, Larry Ashbrook entered the sanctuary. Dressed in black, he methodically opened fire, spewing language. As he shot the first person, then another. Then he paused and he calmly reloaded and began to shoot again. Through all the screams and the smoke and the bloodshed, a 19-year-old boy stood to his feet. His name is Jeremy Netz. He decided he had seen enough. He was going to stand by and watch his friends get shot one by one, and he confronted the gunman. He said, "Sir, you don't have to do that." Ashbrook replied with a foul comment. Nitz said, "I know what you need. You need Jesus Christ in your life." At that moment, the shooter pointed the gun directly at him and started moving toward him. And this is what Nitz said to him, the shooter. He said, "Shoot me if you want. I know where I'm going when I die. What about you?" That statement from that young 19-year-old young man seemed to pierce the heart of that twisted, evil man. Larry Jean Ashbrook's his name. He took a few steps back, uttered a few swear words, sat down and put a gun to his head and pulled the trigger. Now, out of that awful story, there is a shining truth. It is only in knowing God that you can have the certainty that gave this young man, 19-year-old man, the courage to look death in the eye. The only way to know God is through His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. That is the only way. We know John 3:16, don't we? "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whoever believes in Him will not perish but have eternal life." We know that. Can you quote John 3:17? That's where I want us to end. It says these words, "For God did not send His Son into the world to condemn the world, but to save the world through Him." That is the ultimate good news. Jesus came to save you. Do you have the same confidence that young Jeremy Nitz had? Could you stand and face death right in the eye? Say, "Shoot me if you will, I know where I'm going. I have that confidence in what God has done. He has revealed Himself to me, and I have responded by faith." Do we have that? See, it's through Jesus Christ that we can be saved. Our lives can be transformed. We can know God personally, and we can have absolute assurance that we will go to heaven when we die. That is the greatest gift, the greatest news that will ever be told. As I said the last few weeks, the gospel is the only way to be right with God. Get the next slide. I think the next slide. Next slide. Here we go. The gospel. The gospel is good news that God became man in Jesus Christ. He lived the life we should have lived and died the death we should have died in our place. 3 days later, he rose from the dead, proving that he is the God, the Son of God, and offering the gift of salvation for all who repent and believe the gospel. The good news. Next slide. Now, look at that question. See, you see man on one side, God on the other. You see the bridge in the middle, that napkin illustration I was talking about. If you were on that particular diagram, where would you be standing? Are you separated from God? Or are you like that little gold figure, that man there on God's side, because God came to him through Jesus Christ, and by faith, he trusted how God came and what God did. See, the most important question you'll ever answer is that one. Where do you stand? The marvelous thing about the gospel is it's not of ourselves or in ourselves. It's what God has done on our behalf. You can try good works. You can try this. You can try that. It will never work. But God came to you so that you would not have to be condemned, but that you could be saved. I'm going to pray, and I want you to evaluate where you're standing or where you're sitting right now. Do you have that assurance like Jeremy Nance did? We're all staring death in the face. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you so much for creation. It declares your glory. We thank you not only for creation, but the God-shaped vacuum you placed in all of us. The way you create us in your image, in your likeness. We have the ability to know you. We thank you that even in our rebellion, in our stubbornness, that while we were yet sinners, you came. You revealed yourself to us that we might be saved. We thank you for the confidence we can have, that we can know beyond a shadow of a doubt that we can spend eternity with you based on the fact of what Jesus has done. Lord, if there's someone here who does not have that confidence, I pray that today their lives would change. They would realize you came to them. And as Jesus stood on the cross, he stood in our place that we may have his place in heaven. We thank you, Father, for what you have done. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Let's stand this morning. You'd like to have that confidence. Please come take me by the hand.
Never thirst again.
God's people said,
amen.
Amen. Now, thinking about what I shared this morning, how God came to us, I want to leave you with this thought as we're going to be dismissed. He deserves our best. Not our leftovers. Not when we have time. He deserves our best. Amen.
Amen.
Amen.